fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
Who sees firsthand the concrete and mortar, the guard posts and machine gun towers, the dog runs and the barbed wire, can ever again take for granted his or her freedom or the precious gift that is America.
All this stuff you've heard about America not wanting to fight, wanting to stay out of the war, a lot of horse dung. Americans love to fight. All real Americans love staying in the battle.
You want answers? I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!
Welcome to Political Vindication Radio. It's January 25th, and we got a great show scheduled tonight as Michael Reagan, the author of the new book, The New Reagan Revolution, How Ronald Reagan's Principles Can Restore America's Greatness, will join us to talk about the future of the conservative movement and how Ronald Reagan's principles will once again lead America out of the wilderness. In our second hour, we're going to be talking about the possibility of a Keith Olbermann senatorial campaign, the state of Hawaii becoming the first state in the union to ban prayer in its legislature, and the hypocrisy of the SEIU that filed for an Obamacare waiver in the city of Chicago.
We do have Mr. Reagan on, but Michael Reagan, thank you so much for calling in.
How are you doing?
Oh, awesome. It's a great day. You've made our year. Mr. Reagan, joining us.
Where are you all at?
California. I'm out here in Orange County, California.
Yeah. Mr. Reagan, I'm Frank. I'm in Utah.
I'm driving through Norwalk as we speak.
Oh, the beautiful Norwalk. There you are.
I'm headed next to the library to do a book signing tonight.
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, great. Well, listen, every minute is precious, and we'd love to get as much time as we can with you. Frank?
Yeah.
Frank, why don't you take it away, Frank?
Okay, Mr. Reagan, let me ask you. Obviously, you're the author of the book, The New Reagan Revolution, How Ronald Reagan's Principles Can Restore America's Greatness. Wonderful book here. We've been telling our audience about it. But I'd like to start real quick here. We'll get to the book. I'd like to ask you about the State of the Union tonight. We have the president giving the State of the Union. It's a great American tradition by presidents. In your opinion, what is the State of the Union in America today?
The State of the Union is in trouble. I mean, State of the Union is in real, real trouble. And not only here in California, with the unemployment rate skyrocketing, but nationwide with unemployment up, people can't find jobs. People don't feel good about themselves or feel good about America right now. So I'd say the State of the Union is in terrible, terrible shape, and it's up to the leadership in this country to help us make us feel better about this country we live in. I fault the leadership of this country. You know, I fault people who blame America for everything. You know, go overseas and blame America for everything. Don't uplift us to the things that we've accomplished, the things that we've done, the cures we've come up with, the countries we have saved. You know, we have done so many great, wonderful things here in the United States of America, and it's not right and righteous, I think, for leaders who, in fact, do nothing but blame us for the problems and go across and overseas and point bony little fingers back to the United States of America and blame us for the ills of other countries when we're the ones who probably saved them.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Ms. Reagan. But do you think, just real quick here on follow-up, do you think the damage that's being done by the leadership, especially in the White House with a bill like Obamacare, do you think some of this damage is permanent to the country?
No, nothing is permanent in the country. Listen, I've lived long enough to know I've heard this, is it permanent before? You know, no, it's not permanent. It just takes, you know, somebody, a leader, to rise out of the ashes, a phoenix out of the ashes, and to take this country back and make us feel good about the country we live in. That's what my book, The Reagan Revolution, is about, to get back to those basic principles and values. It's not tough to get there. What I don't like is people pretending to be things that they're not. There's so many people out there quoting Ronald Reagan. I want to find the leader I can quote. You know what I'm saying? It's alive today that I can sit there and quote instead of saying that leader can quote Ronald Reagan more than that leader can quote Ronald Reagan. It's like, name Ronald Reagan, and I could name Ronald Reagan in 5 notes. I could do it in 3. I could do it in 2. Name that.
Yeah, but Mr. Reagan, a Reaganism is dead. I mean, we've had Republicans saying that. Republicans saying that Reaganism is dead.
No, it's not. It's not dead. Here's the problem. That you have too many people. Everybody's looking for the next Ronald Reagan, looking for Ronald Reagan. You know, we should be happy that Ronald Reagan lived in our lifetimes and say, gosh, that was great. We had that kind of person in our lifetimes. You know, I think what people are missing right now is they're missing leadership. And so the last leader they really remember is Ronald Reagan. So they're looking for Ronald Reagan. And I worry that we may walk right past the next great leader while we're looking for Ronald Reagan. My thing is, you know, people need to take on responsibility of leading, not looking back, but really leading. And it's all there in the book, The New Revolution, and what to do. And they need to look at big pictures, not small pictures. They need to, you know, make politics not personal, but make it political. And remember that, you know, your enemies on the Hill may be the enemies you have to sleep with to get things done.
Mr. Reagan, I mean, you address the issue of leadership in Chapter 3 of your book. In particular, you know, you say that conservatives must seek bold principles in order to govern successfully. I guess my question is, do you see any within the ranks of the Republican Party that not only holds dear to the principles that your father championed, but do you also see someone with the resilient spirit necessary to face the onslaught of a Washington media complex when these principles actually start to be applied?
Well, you don't know. I mean, is that person out there? May well, very well be out there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the person who may be the nominee of this party in 2012, you may not even heard from yet. It may be Paul Ryan you're going to hear from tonight, you know, out of Wisconsin. You know, it could be the governor of Texas, Rick down there in Texas, you know, just reelected
Rick
for Perry, for his third term, Rick Perry. You've got, you know, somebody who I think is a great guy. Who I think is probably one of the most qualified Republicans who will never run is a guy named Jeb Bush out of Florida. Bilingual, great governor. They love him there. You need the state of Florida to win the election, you know, most likely. So, you know, there's a lot of great people out there. And, you know, the process all helps you, you know, become the person that you are, the president you may become, you know, in the future. But, you know, you can't walk away if indeed, you know, things get rough, because things will get rough. I was talking to some friends of mine the other day who are addressing her help, working with Herman Cain. I told them, I said, whatever Herman Cain doesn't want to talk about is going to be what they want to talk about on the campaign trail. Now, people need to understand, whatever you did in your life that you're ashamed of, just understand that you kept away from your family, they're going to find out about it. And how are you going to deal with it?
Yeah, you know, Ronald Reagan was the man he was before the speech in 1976, before he lost in that primary. And, and you know, I mean, they don't just come out of the blue, Mike.
No,
right?
He never forgets. He never forgot where he's from, never forgot Tampico, Dixon, Illinois, that flyover country that's out there, and never forgot his roots. And that was important. And the thing is, too, as I said, he never made politics personal. Even though he was personally attacked, he didn't return in kind. And sometimes the best answer he ever gave to the question was not an answer. He just didn't say a word. He let his actions
smile
instead of his words. Absolutely right. We have a feeling now in this 24-hour news cycle that people feel like if somebody says something about me, I need to find the microphone. You don't always need to find the microphone. Well, I'll give you an example recently. Okay, Sarah Palin, all right? When she was being attacked because of what was going on in Tucson. She had every conservative radio talk show in America on her team, fighting for her. She didn't say anything. Because now what happened? She said something, so now what's under attack? What she said. And this is knowledge I've had for years, you know, and I keep on saying to some of these candidates, I said, if you want some knowledge how to win elections, call me. Because I've been around since the 1960s through a few elections in my lifetime. I really get it and understand it. Nothing's really changed. But candidates think things have changed. It's like candidates think, you know, I've got to be on Fox every night to do something. But if everybody on Fox voted for you, you'd still lose by 40 million votes.
Sure. Well,
so you need to branch out and get those Reagan Democrats on your team, and then how do you do that?
You tell a great story, too, in your book that I want to touch on real quick. The story about of the 1980 primary against George Bush, where you called your father and you told him that he had to get down to Iowa. I just think that's such a great story. Can you tell our audience about that?
Yeah, it's one of the stories in the book. I was in Iowa campaigning, walking precincts, having coffee, having donuts and what have you, and I got all done with it. I've been chasing George H.W. Bush all over Iowa. You know, challenge him to debates. You know, hey, you know, whatever it took. And he would never defeat me. And it really kind of ticked me off. And, you know, I'm talking to people and they say, where's your dad? And finally I called my dad at the end of my 2-3 weeks in Iowa and I said, you know, Dad, you're gonna get beat by George Bush. I said, I just talked to all the campaign staff. They think we're doing fine. I said, no, you're not. They're running you as if you're already the president. These people here, you're their favorite son, and you're dissing them by not showing up. Tomorrow night, or this weekend, I said, there's a big event WHO's doing downtown Des Moines. All the candidates are going to show up, but you at WHO, that's where you got your start. I said, you're not showing up. My God, they're going to remember that, and they're not going to vote for you. In Iowa, the Iowa caucuses, and he gave us that old dad, well, Michael, thank you very much, I really appreciate that. And then, of course, he got handed to him by George Bush in Iowa 2 weeks later in Des Moines. The day of the primary, my phone rings at 6:30 in the morning, and it's my dad. I'm thinking, what the hell have I done wrong? And because everybody knows that, you two know it also. Your dad calls you at 6:30 in the morning, your first reaction is, what have I done? and so that's what I'm thinking. And I said, yeah, hi, Dad, how are you? He says, how are you? I said, good. He says, you awake? I said, yeah. And he says, I have a press release. I said, well, that's nice. He says, but I can't release it to the press without your approval. I said, why mine? He says, let me read the press release. It's the press release firing his complete campaign staff on the morning of the New Hampshire primary. And he said, well, do I have your approval to give it to the media? And I said, yeah, why are you asking me? He says, you're the only one that was honest with me about Iowa. I should have trusted your judgment then.
Oh.
And he said, but now, I said, what happens if I would have said no? I wouldn't have fired him. But I said, but you called me, he says, because I knew you'd fire him. You know, so he gave the press release to the media, and the rest is absolutely history, and I talk about that in the book. And those people, when I go on in that chapter, it says, those people are still being hired by stupid Republicans to run campaigns that they never win. And those people are still using my dad's 1980 campaign as if they had something to do with him winning. If they had anything to do with him winning, they got fired.
We are speaking with Michael Reagan, author of The New Reagan Revolution, How Ronald Reagan's Principles Can Restore America's Greatness. I call it the Reagan's Rules for Revolution. I think, Mike, that's been a couple years. Everybody's going to have a little paperback of this folded in half in their back pocket as we take to the streets. Let me tell you, we've been hearing a lot about violent political environment we're in lately, and all this right-wing talk is responsible for murders, Mike, mayhem, you know, and of course, it's never been as bad as it is now, right, Mike? I mean, there's never been a time when it was so bad as now.
Oh, no, listen, when they were doing duels, you know, outside the House of Representatives back in the founding days of our country. No, it's never been bad. You know, it's really interesting. I don't remember all this talk when Hinckley shot my father. I don't remember people calling for calmness. Yeah. Let's be calm. Let's cut out the old rhetoric against Ronald Reagan. Let's really, you know, I don't quite remember those things. When Gerald Ford was shot, I don't remember that happening. It always seems when, you know, Democrats are in office, they use that as an excuse. You know, myself and Ollie North and Rush Limbaugh were Timothy McVeigh. And I'm going like, this is kind of interesting because Ollie North had just been in radio 2 weeks and Brian Gumbel from NBC was already naming him as a co-conspirator with Michael Reagan and Rush Limbaugh in making Timothy McVeigh go nuts and blow up the Murrah Federal Building in Oklahoma City. I mean, this is what the left does. They're always trying to put you know, blame somewhere other than maybe looking inward.
Well, listen, when you're calling Ronald Reagan for years a warmonger, a man who's a hater, a man who hates gays, the man who purposefully stop funding for AIDS. I mean, you have a whole – I mean, I have a book here that I got from the library a few weeks ago that are posters from the 80s, political posters from the 80s. Mr. Reagan. I mean, it's incredible to read what's in it. Have we all forgotten how absolutely nasty it was when Ronald Reagan was president in this country?
Ronald Reagan was smart enough to take those negatives and turn them into positives for himself. So, you know, the left kept on making him out to be a warmonger. And you remember, he never said he wasn't. He never said he wasn't. And by not saying he wasn't, ended up on the day that he's sworn in, the Iranian hostages being freed, because the Iranians had no idea what this warmonger was going to do. He was smart enough. Mm. Here's another example of you don't always have to answer to your critics. Sometimes it's smarter to say nothing. And by Ronald Reagan saying nothing, he didn't dissuade the Soviets, he didn't dissuade the Iranians from thinking that this guy may just come blow us up. And it was terrific. The way he did that, you know, like it's like the radio show when he said, well, no, I didn't know the microphone was on when he said, you know, he was up at the ranch doing his radio show and said, you know, I just gave the order the Soviet Union will end in 5 minutes. I mean, stuff like that. Just he knew how to use the moment. And today we don't have politicians know how to use it. They used to speak in sound bites. They don't speak in parables. And they don't know how to really use the moment. And it's not that they can't learn, but they use the excuse that they weren't in Hollywood as an excuse to fail. Yeah. What do? You should be going to school, some kind of a school, to learn how to turn those positives or negatives into positives.
Mr. Reagan, you know, I think one of the brilliant points you make in your book is you talk about, you know, every generation has to stand up at some point to fight for their freedom. And you say the challenge for America in the 1980s was the fight against the Soviet Union, and today it's Islamofascism. And I would agree with those principles, Mr. Reagan, but during the Cold War, we had an enemy that had clear political boundaries, real physical borders between nations, to where Americans and your father was able to take the fight to the Soviets. But what do you do against an enemy that has no nation, waves no flag, and wears no uniform? How do we apply the Reagan principles to this war?
You know, it's the old adage my dad used to use, peace through strength. You've got to be strong. You can't cave to these people. You can't live in a country where, you can't call them Islamo-fascist because that may offend them. You've got to call people what they are. Remember my father's evil empire speech? He gave that at Notre Dame University, right? Evil empire. Look how far that went. Sometimes you have to really call a spade here, and you need to really, when you sit down from strength. You have Barack Obama thinking if you make friends with all these people. You know, when he goes into the White House, and one of the first things he does in the White House is send the Winston Churchill bus back to London because it so offends him. I mean, things like that. Or, in fact, he tells the Czech Republic and he tells Poland, I'm taking away your missile defense shield. That sends a message. Or when he says, I'm going to sit down with Ahmadinejad, that sends a message. Or he bends over and starts kissing fingers and hands and feet and everything else. That sends message. You've got to send messages of strength.
Yeah.
And if you're going to retaliate, it's got to be quick and to the point. I think the problem we've got into with George Bush, W., and others, is they have this feeling that they're, even though they're president of the United States, they have this undying feeling that they, if they want to do anything necessary to protect the U.S., they have to call the United Nations to get permission. And I tell the story in the book about Gaddafi. You know, I'm at dinner with my wife and my dad, Nancy. They're here in Los Angeles, and Ed Meese calls just before we leave. We're having coffee. And Ed Meese says, you know, Mr. President, we're doing war games in the Gulf of Sidra. And my dad says, well, I know that, Ed. And he says, well, yeah, but Gaddafi's sending planes out, and they're locking onto our boys, and there's a worry that, in fact, that they may shoot at our guys. What should we do if our planes are shot at? My dad says, well, shoot back. And Ed said, well, yeah, but what happens if they shoot, turn, and run? And my dad said, well, you chase them. and say, okay, what happens if they shoot Mr. President? They turn and run back into their own airspace. My dad said, Ed, I don't care if they shoot, turn, and run. You will chase them all the way back to their hangars if necessary. But when you get to their hangars, you will shoot them down. Now, then Ed said, well, Mr. President, do I need to call you and wake you? My dad said, no. The next morning, if you go back historically, look at that day, the next morning, the argument in the press wasn't about the two downed MiGs, living MiGs. The argument in the press was, what do you mean, Ed, you didn't call the President of the United States? Well, he said not to. And they went to my dad. My dad said, I told Ed, if our guys get shot down, call me. If they get shot down, let me sleep.
That's the story that you have in Chapter 12, No Substitute for Victory. I have it marked here. I love that story. And this whole book is full of stories. And see, that's something. You don't lecture, Mr. Reagan. You give examples. And that's something that your father also talked about. Give me examples.
I try and
do it. It's incredible.
Because there's so many people who say, what would Ronald Reagan do? And what I do in the book is show you what he did. When faced with the same things we're faced with now, what did he do? This is what he did. You know, the story in the book about, you know, the fact that my dad's working for General Electric. He has a hit television series. It's on every Sunday night at 9 o'clock in the top 10 all the time. He's out speaking all over the country to GE employees. And General Electric's government contracts come up for renewal. And who calls him on the phone? Bobby Kennedy calls GE on the phone and says to GE, if you want your government contracts renewed, you need to cancel GE Theater and fire that host. And about 72 hours later, GE Theater's off the air. Ronald Reagan's fired. He's jobless. That's how he got the job with Borax, as the old ranger with Borax. But he was now available to do work for Goldwater, and he was available to give the greatest speech in the history of mankind known to us, known as the speech, A Time for Choosing. If Bobby Kennedy doesn't make the call, A Time for Choosing speech may never have been given.
Wow. Boy, out of lemons, you make margaritas. I love that.
That's what Ronald Reagan did, and we don't do that anymore.
Mr. Reagan, you talk of bold colors. You say, it's time for bold colors. Are you suggesting that it's okay to start taking a position on social issues again? Because, you know, up till now, everybody's been telling us to shut up and ride the bad economy to victory. Mr. Reagan?
Well, you know, there's nothing wrong with it, bold colors or social issues and whatever. But what I say in the book is, you'll never find the last perfect person I know of was Jesus Christ. You're never going to find the perfect candidate. There's always going to be warts somewhere on the candidate. Ronald Reagan didn't let, the social issues so much get in the way of the bigger agenda. What's the big issue? Like here in California, the big issue here is jobs, taxes, businesses are leaving. Now, if a Republican comes up who's going to tell me how they're going to create jobs, lower taxes, and get the economy rolling again, am I going to ask them that they're pro-life or pro-choice? No, because that's not the issue. The issue is the economy here. That's the real issue. And, I talked about in the book, you give an example in the book on the fact that, when you're talking about abortion, I'm a huge pro-life guy because I'm adopted. And my dad was huge pro-life. But, he wrote a book in 83, Abortion, the Conscience of a Nation, supported his daughter Maureen in 92, a pro-choice Republican. Pro-life people wouldn't support her. She lost. Jane Harmon won. So are we better off because now a pro-choice liberal Democrat won? Does that make sense when Ronald Reagan agreed with his daughter 80% of the time? Or myself, when I talk about, when I speak to pro-life groups, that 69% of abortions are done on young girls who profess to be Catholic or Protestant. 69%. Shouldn't the question be, why are our daughters getting abortions, and what can we do to solve it? And the answer to that, one of the answers I give to that, because I speak quite a bit, is our daughters are more fearful of mom and dad than they are of the abortionist. And when you are raised in a family that says, if you ever embarrass this family of getting pregnant, I'm an elder in the church, I'm a deacon in the church, I'm the mayor in the community, I'm governor, I'm this, I'm that, don't you ever embarrass this family. Don't ever do it. if a daughter gets pregnant, what do you think she's going to do? Come home and tell dad, or go find an abortion clinic and try and keep it as quiet as possible? And the point I make when I go out and speak is this, that, you know, everybody can quote John 3:16, but how many people live it? How many people are willing to get on a cross and die for their own daughters or children's sins? And when we fathers start getting on the crosses and dying on those crosses for our own daughters and children's sins and have a loving heart as God loved us and allowed his son to die for our sins, we won't have to go to the government to solve a problem we might have solved right at our own dinner table.
That's wonderful, Mr. Reagan. But you know, the charge, though, has been from the blue bloods, I guess, if you want to call it, the Rockefeller Republicans, has always been that you have a Reagan never wore his pro-life badge on his shoulder. He kind of put it in his back pocket, and really that was the key to victory there, that the social issues never were, the main part of his platform.
But it was part of the platform. It was part of the bold color platform. But it was part of the platform. Everybody knew he was pro-life, but the issues in those days, as much as today, you know, again, back to 76, and the book is based on that speech, you give that same speech today. Absolutely the same speech today, and it would ring as true today as it did back in 76. The issues today aren't pro-life, pro-choice. The issues today are people can't find jobs. You got children 30 years old moving back into their parents' home. You've got people sitting on the street corner. People don't have a way up. They don't know how to get up because there's nobody leading to get them there. You know, once they're there, go ahead, talk about your other issues, but the major issues in the country we're living in today is your 10% unemployment that's out there and just this feeling of, God, where are we? Where are we going? What are we doing? And I think we need to get that house truly, truly in order. Would it help by putting God in back in the room? Absolutely.
Yeah.
It would help me putting God back in the room. But you know what I say to a lot of people who say, well, if God was only back in the schools, things would change. You know what I do? I say in the book, I challenge those people. I say, fine, how many of you today prayed with your children before they went to school? You know, so Christians need to quit griping about no prayer in school if they're not willing to pray with their own children before they go out the door.
Mr. Reagan, on page 257, you say, I don't know about you, but I fear for our nation when it is led by people who are committed to the decline of America. That's a pretty grave charge.
Oh, it is a grave charge, but I think it's a very true charge when you take the Harry Reid's, Nancy Pelosi, and the decline. You know, when is any one of the three of them uplifted America? When have they not blamed America? You have the President of the United States who's gone overseas to foreign countries and pointed a finger at America and blamed America for all the ills going on in other parts of the world, which is just absolutely not true. And so that to me is not the way you uplift our country, or in fact instill in other countries a vibrancy of knowing America is going to be there to support you. There's no other country in the world that is available to protect the freedoms of other nations in the world. They just don't exist. The world needs America to be vibrant, to be free, and to be strong, because that's the only country they can count on, whether there's tsunamis or invasions, whatever they might be. And if we're not strong to do that, if there are people who want to dismantle the military, if there's people who, in fact, are really working towards the decline of this country, then it does a disservice to the world, not just the United States of America.
Yes, one of the quotes of Ronald Reagan, of the four wars in my lifetime, none came about because the U.S. was too strong.
That's right. Every one of them. Right. Go back and do the history. Absolutely right.
Mr. Reagan, one of the critiques about your father at the university level is that the Soviet Union was never really that strong concerning the Cold War. Their economy was in shambles, which hence probably meant that their military was in shambles as well. The Cold War, was it real, or was the Soviet Union a lot weaker than we thought during the 80s?
People need to understand there's really a two-pronged approach against the Soviet Union. And if you go back and read what my father was doing, he had strong rhetoric on one side. But on the other side, we were undermining the ruble and the currencies of the Soviet blocs. So we were undermining their economy. I remember sitting with Mikhail Gorbachev, and we were doing a town hall together. And I said, you know, how bad was your economy? You know, President Gorbachev, he said, oh, my God, it was so bad. Through his attorney, he said, it was so bad. He said, I had the women of Moscow were just, oh, my God, they couldn't find pantyhose. I had to appoint a czar of pantyhose to get pantyhose into the Soviet Union so that they would be happy. My God, they were so unhappy. But again, we were breaking their economy at the same time that we were busting them on the other side. And what would my father say when he sat down with Mikhail Gorbachev? He simply leaned across at him and said, listen, you can't beat me in a spending war. I can outspend you. I can spend you into darkness. And that's where Ronald Reagan was going. And that's exactly what he did. But remember, up until the Ronald Reagan comes into office, we had the taunt. Simply was, hey, and you tell your guys in college, the taunt was, as long as you're only killing your people, that's okay. Just don't kill any of our guys. Ronald Reagan came in and said, there's a change going on here, and the change is simply this. Foreign policy from now is, we win, they lose.
See that now with Barack Obama when he allowed that election to be stolen in Iran, did nothing about that as those people were being slaughtered in the streets. Even a few words, Mr. Reagan, just a few words thrown in their direction would have meant so much. Look at the landscape now. Tunisia going down. I hear Egypt today, riots in the street. We got China here humiliating us, a state dinner for China over here with our Nobel winner, Obama.
You know, I write in the book, I forget what chapter it's in, but I said, it's interesting that China seems to be the only one that learned, China and Russia, are the only ones that learned what Ronald Reagan did to bust the Soviet bloc, because what Ronald Reagan did to them is exactly what China is now doing to us.
Right. So what's a president who cares about freedom to do? In 2011, Mr. Reagan.
What you have to do is you have to educate the masses of people. At some point, the people have to just have to all of a sudden get it and understand the fact that they are having their freedoms eroded each and every day in this nation. And if they don't rise up and change, and if the Republican Party doesn't have someone to come out like the Phoenix and tell us where he wants to take us, we have someone to follow. Got nobody to follow in the next election. Barack Obama will be reelected. If the people who want to be president of the United States read my book and learn from my book, we'll have a new leader emerge who will become the president in 2012.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. It's worth every page. We've been talking to Michael Reagan, author of The New Reagan Revolution, How Ronald Reagan's Principles Can Restore America's Greatness. It is a book that has got a million and one stories, and this is a man who brings to life not only the past, but he brings it to the future right now. We're living it. This is a generation that can make a difference. I count one of the leaders as you, Mr. Reagan, and I appreciate you so much for all that you've done and all that you stand for. I remember listening to you sitting on a freeway in Los Angeles on KABC, sir, and you challenging the Republican Party to stand for principle. You're still doing it. You're still fighting. Sir, I can't say enough about you, and what an honor it's been to have you on our show. I tell you again, you've made our year, and I think Frank just may start crying. He's so proud of you and everything that you represent, sir.
You guys take care. I've just arrived at the Nixon Library. I'm looking forward to tonight.